Hey guys, so I'm gonna tell you guys what happened to me a couple days ago. I'm actually glad it happened a couple days ago instead of the last couple days because of the whole situation with the snowstorm out here. So basically, I was at the Home Depot getting some stuff. Parked my car, was there for about an hour, and then I came back out ready to go back and try to start my car, and guess what guys, it cranked up okay. Everything worked, it cranked up okay, but it wouldn't turn over. And I must have tried it about five times cranking it up before I just settled on, you know, settled on there being something wrong with the car. Kind of knew there was something wrong with the car, considering it was cranking and wouldn't turn over. But had to try it a couple of times, more than a couple of times, just to... Well, I was hoping that it wasn't anything that I couldn't fix by just maybe trying it a couple of times and then doing the whole shifting from park to other gears and then trying to start it up and then pressing the accelerator a couple of times, seeing if that helped, and you know, five, six times. And after that, I kind of gave up on it because it wouldn't turn over. It would crank. It would... You guys know what that is. You guys, it makes that noise when it cranks up. Just fine. It just wouldn't turn over. And those cranks were very, very strong cranks. They were very strong cranks. It wasn't any kind of slow crank, any kind of... And that was a bit worrisome to me because, you know, if it was like a slow crank or a weak crank, I might have assumed that it was probably the battery or something like that. But considering it was a strong crank every single time I tried to crank it, you know. So basically, I was still hoping that it was something simple like the battery. So what I did was I turned on my headlights and went out to check to see whether the headlights were bright or not. And the headlights were very, very, very bright. So basically, I couldn't really make heads or tails of that, considering, well, I kind of could, but I was... hoping that it was the battery, because since I was at the Home Depot, you know, if it was the battery, I could have just hopped into the Home Depot and they probably had the brand of battery for the car. But anyway, after that, I put the hood up and you know, checked the battery, because for whatever reason, I kind of thought that, you know, it had something to do with the battery. I was hoping that it had something to do with the battery. So I was checking the battery, checking the terminals, you know, checking a bunch of other things. But thing about it, I changed out the battery maybe like a year ago. Changed out the battery about a year ago because, you know, it kind of died on me. Like, I couldn't get it started before. Wasn't really the same situation because it wasn't cranking when the battery situation happened. But this situation right here, it's cranking pretty good. So, I remember I did not clean up the terminals, and they were kind of, you know, there was some corrosion on there when I changed out the battery a while ago. So I was looking at the terminals, and the terminals looked very, very, very corroded. There was like a lot of blue, whitish stuff on there. So, I took out the Coke that I got, that I drank half of from the Home Depot, that I bought from the Home Depot, and I pretty much poured the rest of it onto the terminals, and it fizzed up, oxidated, started oxidizing, the corrosion, took a paper towel and pretty much wiped it, and the terminals were not, they weren't super tight, they were tight enough. All right, I could wiggle it out wiggle it back in. And I kind of wiggle it out, clean the inside, wiggle it back in a couple of times just to make sure that, you know, it was rubbing the corrosion off. So basically, I did that, popped it back on, you know, went back into my car and tried to start it. And it cranked like before, did it about three times, cranked like before, it just wouldn't turn over. So at that point, I was like, okay, it might be a bigger situation at that point. And went back out, checked out the negative cable, which is the major ground wire for the whole electrical system of the car. If you guys don't know what the ground wire is, it pretty much completes the circuit. So the ground wire, the major ground wire, if you're in a situation like this and when you're looking for issues with the ground wire, you could just pretty much just trace the negative line, the negative terminal. And normally negative terminal is bolted onto the frame. So I traced the negative line and it was fine. There was a little bit of rust on it, but nothing out of the ordinary. It was tight. It wasn't brittle. It didn't break off. It wasn't, no, it, you know, it was good. All right, the cable was good. There was no portion of it that was broken off. It was good. So at that point, I was able to pretty much troubleshoot as far as eliminating the battery being the cause, eliminating the terminals being the cause, eliminating the negative line being the cause, which is the ground wire, eliminating also the alternator. Now, normally in this situation, it wouldn't be the alternator to begin with, but just to be sure, I did put a battery pack that I had bought from Walmart a year ago, and it was at 75%, but it was good enough. I popped it on anyway. I didn't think that was going to make any difference. So I popped it on and tried to try to crank up my car afterwards. It cranked, obviously. It did the same thing. I tried it three times. It cranked, but it did not turn over. So at that point, you know, I could rule it out completely, all those things, including the alternator, which if it was the alternator, which it probably wouldn't have been, couldn't have been. But if it was, the car would have started, and then once I took the booster pack off, it would have died off. So basically, I could eliminate all those things. So I was scratching my head trying to figure out what it was, I was thinking maybe it could be a bunch of other things, but then I realized that there was no check engine light on the car. I haven't had a check engine light on the car since I had it, actually. Haven't had a check engine light, surprisingly. But there's no check engine light on the car. So at that point, I was able to rule out a bunch of other stuff. Everything else that had a sensor connected to it that the car would have read if there was some kind of malfunction, I was able to pretty much rule out. And that pretty much includes the mass airflow sensor, the throttle position sensor, the camshaft position sensor, the crankshaft position sensor, and, you know, the common things that could have caused a situation like that. But I had an OBD2 reader, a cheap $20 OBD2 reader that I had bought from Walmart. And I plugged it in, okay? And the reason why I plugged it in was to make sure of a couple of things. And one of those things was that it wasn't a computer issue. Sometimes if the computer has an issue with being connected to the car itself, it would cause a crank no start situation. So I plugged it in, and if the OBD2 was able to read it through and then analyze it and give me a readout, I knew that that wasn't the case. Normally, computer issues could exist because the car's computer could be malfunctioning. There would be a short somewhere, or a fuse issue, blown fuse to the car's ECU, ECM. But you know, it gave me a readout. No codes. All clear. So I could rule out everything I mentioned. Which was the mass airflow sensor, the camshaft position sensor, the crankshaft position sensor, the throttle position sensor, rule all those out. I could also rule out the battery at that point. Now, seeing as how I ruled all those things out, there was only a couple things that could have caused it. Being as this is a general troubleshooting assessment that I did, I was like, okay, so it could be the ignition cylinder, fob key could sometimes do that, security, the relay, the fuses, fuel pump, fuel filter clogged up, a bunch of those things. But at that point, I was pretty much trying to test out the things that I could test out. And I was pretty much in that situation where I was going through the things that I could test out without needing any kind of without having taking anything apart, pretty much. So I was like, I got to where the fuses were. I looked at the fuses just to see whether there was any kind of if I could see a blown fuse, if I smelled any kind of burnt smell at all. And was not able to detect whether there was a blown fuse. I did not have a fuse tester on me, and I don't know. I don't know if the Home Depot sold fuse tester. They might. I'm not sure, but it didn't cross my mind to actually go and get one. I didn't think it was a fuse to begin with, but I couldn't have been 100% sure of that. At that point, I was left with a couple of scenarios. One of those scenarios was either the fuel pump or fuel relay. Now, I was before I did the check out the fuses, I was sitting in my car and I was thinking to myself, okay, this is the situation you're in. Thinking to myself, I could test out the fuel. I could tell whether the fuel pump, normally you could hear the fuel pump prime. All right. If you have the ignition on the on position, normally what happens is it sends electrical charge to the fuel pump motor. The fuel pump motor does its work and it sends out, pressurizes the system. You can actually hear it. Now, seeing as how there was only me in the car, I wasn't able to test it out efficiently, which is like when you have another person right next to where the fuel cap is, you would take the fuel cap off and then listen while the person in the car turn the car to the on position. And normally, you know, you would be able to hear a slight whizzing sound, a motorized sound, something like that. But seeing as how I did not have another person there with me, I sat in my car and I turned it to the on position without cranking it, because if you crank it, what happens is you're going to miss the slight sound of the fuel pump priming. So seeing as how there was only me, I sat and sat in the car, turned off everything, had the windows up, and then pretty much just try to turn it to the on position about three times, and then turn it off, turn it to the on position, turn it off, turn it on, turn it off, just to see whether I could hear some kind of whizzing sound, some kind of motorized sound. And unfortunately, I wasn't able to detect that. So so from there, I actually went to test the fuses. I couldn't tell whether it was 100% the fuses or not, but when I got to the relay, I was thinking, well, maybe it's the fuel pump relay. So what I did was, I actually, could not tell whether the relay had issues or not. So, but, there was another relay, on the board that I could swap out. So what I did was I swapped it out. Got back in my car and try to start it, and guess what, guys, it just turned over immediately.
So at that point, I knew 100% that it was the fuel pump relay that was causing that issue. And basically, I drove to AutoZone, bought the relay, pretty much just did a little switching around, and haven't had any issues with it since. I didn't have any issues with it yesterday. I haven't been out today because of the big snowstorm, but it works fine. It worked fine all day yesterday. It was 100% the fuel pump relay. Now, if you guys are in this situation where, you know, your car is having this issue, where it's cranking, but it won't turn over, it won't start. Pretty much, if you guys go down the list of everything that I pretty much went through myself as far as troubleshooting, 90% of the time you guys will probably figure out what the situation is from that. Hope this has helped you guys out in some way. Hopefully it's not a major issue that's causing your problem. But if you like this video, please give me a thumbs up. Please subscribe. And any comments at all, guys, please leave a comment in the comment section. All right, guys, take care.